All right, enough Paris Saint-Germain. How about some quick hits instead?
Let's go, Gab.
Real Madrid and Manchester City battled to a 3-3 draw at the Bernabeu. Jules, this was some game.
Wow. Well, yeah, one of the games of the season without doubt. Gabby, some of the goals, the quality. I mean, they can try it again. Valverde, Foden, Vardiol especially, more than the other two.
Vardiol more than Foden. Yes, yeah, weaker Foden.
Yeah, Foden, you've seen that one before on his left. I think Valverde can hit a volley like that.
But I also kind of feel Vardiol, he has no idea where the ball's going to go, whereas Foden seems like, you know, it's almost like he's got a remote control.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I mean. That's why for Vardiol, he can try again. He will never score the same one. Foden, we will see more like that. Valverde as well. Vardiol, incredible. When you look at the XG, 0.7 for both. Shows you to finish it 3-3 with six goals.
Those are quality finishes.
Yeah, amazing finishes. And it really was what we kind of expected, to be fair, because Real Madrid played in transition, on the counter. To have Vinicius and Rodrigo both on the same side was really good from Carlo.
We're going to get to that, Jules.
Tactically, of course. And then the way Pep responded, that second half performance from City, I thought was pretty impressive as well.
I mean, I thought there was a long spell in the middle of the game where, in fact, I think it was a long spell where City didn't have a single shot, where it looked to me like Real Madrid were able to defend so well that they have completely neutralized City.
But you can't keep it up for...
You can't keep it up. Also, because ultimately, and I think this is a difference, you know, and speaking more broadly about these four games, we saw a lot of mistakes, but we also saw so much individual quality. And you can't always legislate against it because it's not necessarily a defensive mistake. Sometimes you just get beaten by the individual. And that's what City were, I think, able to do very effectively to take charge of this and then that final goal.
Yeah. And Gab, we just mentioned it. Carlo Ancelotti pulled something different out of his hat by moving Rodrigo to the left and deploying Vinicius through the middle.
Yeah, or middle, but of course, because Vinicius always goes left because that's
middle
his tendency.
Left. Middle left.
You create a mismatch. And look, who says that formations have to be symmetrical, right? Yeah. I mean, I thought that worked extremely well, especially with no Kyle Walker there. And some people said, ooh, look, you know, Rodrigo's auditioning for, you know, you put Mbappe there for Rodrigo. And Mbappe and Vinicius can both play together on the left. I don't know. Let's cross that bridge when we get to it.
Yeah, it might not work all the time.
You have those options also if you have people with the tactical intelligence of Valverde and Jude Bellingham. Mm. That's what allows you to do it. But yeah, sometimes Carlo Ancelotti likes to throw curveballs.
Nah, he's good. He's really good.
Jules, we talk endlessly about how important Rodri is to City. But now he has said he needs a rest. This kind of comes at the worst possible time.
Yeah, and I thought the game on Tuesday night at the Bernabeu was one of his, not worst, because he was not.
No, he had his worst one. Was it last weekend or the weekend before?
But you could, I think you can tell, because he loses some balls that he doesn't lose usually. A mispass that is never a mispass for a player of his caliber and the form that he's been on. And yeah, maybe when you play already more than 4,000 minutes for club and country this season, that's a lot of minutes, that's a lot of football. That maybe starts to be heavy for him. And the thing is, really, when you had Fernandinho before, you had Rodri arrived to be the successor and the heir to Fernandinho. But then Fernandinho was still there to be a good backup at some point, even at his old age. Now, really, there's no backup. Yeah, you can play Rico Lewis, you can play Kovacic, you can play Mateus Nunez maybe, but there's not another Rodri in that position to be able to rest him.
No, there's no, well, first of all, there's no other
No, but
Rodri.
You see what I mean? Just another profile.
There's
I mean,
no
Gavin Phillips was
no,
the one.
I think you can do it. You can play those guys if Stones is fit, stepping into midfield. If he's not, then it does tend to screw things up. What I find extraordinary is he played a ton of minutes last year too, and they have all these sports science guys. It shouldn't come to the point where Rodri comes out and says this
himself,
publicly.
You mean,
it should be before saying, guys, we're heading, he's in the red zone. Let's sit him in some of these other games. Let's see what we need to do to work with him. It's interesting. I have this list from the Times. The guy who's played the most, he's actually 10th in Europe for club and country. The guy who's played the most by far, like more than 100 minutes in the number two guy, is actually Bruno Fernandes. Which is pretty remarkable. I think he's actually the only attacking midfielder on the list. So it just tells you a lot about Bruno. Jules, we're not done. We got more quick hits.
Yes.
Arsenal and Bayern battled to a 2-2 draw at the Emirates on Tuesday night, which leaves a tie wide open. But Mikel Arteta has to be very grumpy about some of those stupid defensive mistakes.
Completely, especially the first goal that they gave away. Raya coming out of his goal like that. Gabriel with a terrible pass towards Kivior. Then it's really well played from a Bayern point of view. Sané to Goretzka to Gnabry. But still, very, very avoidable. Even the second, the penalty for Leroy Sané to run
across the area like that,
half of the pitch, like, you know, but it shows and
again. I blame Gabriel there more than Saliba.
But it shows some are still learning. They're still young team for some of them. No,
we haven't seen this immaturity.
This is not Luton and Sheffield United and Nottingham. This is Bayern Munich and a Bayern team that hasn't been great in the Bundesliga, but it's still. That's what you see on those nights. You see those teams that are great. We talked about Barca, some people dissing Bayern. All of that. They're still so good and so competitive.
And at the end, Bayern hit the post.
Yeah, come on.
Won the game.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, there was other controversy with the referee, Gab, which is the next quickest. If we stick with that game, Thomas Tuchel was furious at referee Glenn Nyberg for not awarding a penalty for Bayern after Gabriel handled the ball on like a goal kick. It was so weird. Was Tuchel right?
No, Tuchel's completely wrong. I mean,
I wrote
a column about this. He was wrong to say what he did because there's the spirit of the law and then there's the letter of the law. And if you want to be some persnickety stickler when it's in your favor and say, nine, look, nobody touched the ball, right? Again, I'm assuming everybody's seen this, but Arsenal, it's a goal kick to Arsenal. Raya, the whistle goes. Raya touches it towards Gabriel, who either doesn't hear the whistle or is just being stupid. Yeah. He picks the ball up and he gives it back to Raya. And then he was so angry because the referee apparently said, well, this is a kid's mistake. Yeah. Like, I can't give a penalty. There's certain basic tenets, I think, about laws and rules in football matches, right? They're there to stop the players from getting injured and to make sure that nobody gets an unfair advantage.
Yeah.
And when you get punishments for those laws, they tend to be proportional, right? A shirt tug does not give you an automatic red card, right? Not going back 10 meters doesn't mean that you don't give it a penalty, right? In this case, a penalty would have been completely disproportionate for it.
Yeah.
So Tuchel should know better. If he wants to go and make it about himself and blame the referee, then get angry about, I thought, the Kane should have been sent off.
Yeah.
You want to go there,
me
right?
Me too, 100%.
You know, that...
Where'd you stand on the Saka penalty?
Oh, that's, I think Saka either loses control, doesn't realize where he is, and looks for the contact. I thought that was the correct call. The one argument, there was one incident where Gabriel and Kane were wrestling in the box where I thought Gabriel got a little too handsy.
Yeah, he does that a lot, to be fair.
But then also Kane's very good at drawing penalties, so,
yeah.
You know, six...
Great one, game overall, anyway.
Yeah, look, it was really entertaining. Not as entertaining as what we saw in at the Bernabeu at the Parc des Princes. It's my luck for choosing this one. Still. Atletico Madrid beat Borussia Dortmund 2-1 in the other quarterfinal first leg. Jules, we saw Dortmund defending horribly. Yeah. Not a surprise.
Nope.
But we also saw Atleti nearly self-destructing at home, which is much more of a surprise. Julian Brandt with that last-ditch woodwork.
Yeah, why is Julian Brandt not starting that game is beyond me. I mean, Edin Terzic maybe doesn't want to be the manager anymore next season if he keeps making those mistakes, because this is not the plan. Felix Nemcha starts and
I don't need to see that guy ever again.
It's one of the worst.
Not for Dortmund.
One of the worst. We talked about Asensio and how bad Asensio was in the first half. Our friend Felix, that was even worse. It was embarrassing at times. When Brand came on, much better. His header right at the end, hit the woodwork. He was involved, obviously, on the Alea goal as well. Much better from Dortmund in the second half when Atletico just dropped deeper.
No,
and stopped playing.
I have the issue so much with the dropping deeper. That's how you play. You hit them on the counter. But they had chances, the Correa chance especially, and others.
Great,
they could have put this game
to them. They should have, to be fair.